Okay, let us go ahead and get ourselves started with session 14 of 120B, 220B. Today we are going to continue talking about HVAC systems. So the first of the various mechanical and electrical plumbing systems. We started looking at the whole issue of ventilation just a little bit last time in terms of thinking about how we start deciding how much ventilation is needed in an individual space based on a lot of different criteria. As I said, there's like four different reasons. There are four different things that help you determine how much air you might need to have come into a room based on its healthiness and kind of keeping the air fresh and moving, but also in terms of if we're using the air as a way of delivering heat or cool as our primary medium for kind of delivering that. But we'll talk today about how we apply some of that stuff to specifically going through and designing things. So today we will learn all about just really how we both go ahead and kind of calculate some of the different requirements, how we take some of the information about the code requirements and build it into a Revit model so we can use Revit as a calculator to help us keep track of just how many cubic feet of air we do need to be moving around, but also then how we model systems to supply that and just really check the two things, make sure they're in balance with each other and that you have a system that is fully functioning. So we'll do a little bit of both. In terms of the integrated design project, I think most people are signed up. Many folks have already met with Alana. A lot of folks are meeting with this week. Please continue to sign up with times if you haven't done so already, or if there isn't a time available, let me know and we'll kind of make a time available. I have some time later this afternoon. Is anyone meeting this afternoon with Alana? No, tomorrow? Who hasn't met with Alana yet this week? You two have, and are there times, are there times not available, or what's going on, or do we need to add some more times, or are there times and you're just trying to decide when to do it?
Are there hours today?
Oh, there may not be any posted today. I'm going to be around just this afternoon. I probably don't have it posted. If anyone wants to meet later this afternoon, I think I'm meeting with my rendering folks at 3:30, but at like 4:30, 5, 5:30, something like that. If anyone wants to meet this afternoon, we can do it this afternoon, or if not tomorrow. We'll just try and find a time. Just so if you haven't found a time, one that doesn't fit in, let me know about it, and we'll try to make a time for you. We'll figure out a specific time to make it happen. Okay? That makes sense? And then in terms of where you are, most people are actually in pretty good shape. There's a lot of great looking structures floating around there, some particularly interesting structures floating around out there. And the idea is we're going to help you figure out some subset of the structure to go through and do an analysis of a member or two. You don't want to be analyzing the entire structure. Okay, and just really trying to refine it. Even if you have a very big building, I can think of someone that has a very big building, if you don't end up sort of modeling all the structure in great detail, that's fine too. You know, really what we're gonna do for a lot of the things going on now, as we, especially if you're looking at a big building, is go ahead and choose a portion thereof. You know, multi-building complex, choose a portion that you really wanna start thinking about how all the systems integrate together. You got a very big building, think of a corner or a portion of it that you can do it to. Because it's, it can be a huge task in terms of trying to get everything all together. So don't let the sheer size of your project overwhelm you. Okay, let's start talking about just HVAC systems and the overall strategy about how we approach this. That is, there's a lot of ways we can go ahead and provide heating, ventilating, and air conditioning to buildings. That's part of what makes it so confusing. Whereas in structure, there's probably three main strategies you can go after, at least in terms of materials, and then you can think of a lot of sort of spatial strategies for what you want to do. HVAC, there's almost like an infinite number of combinations, and they'll have slightly different advantages and disadvantages. But one thing I'd love you to start doing just as we get going is to just observing everywhere you go, see if you can sort of figure out how the HVAC system is working. For example, in this building, in the Y2E2 building, where we all spend so much of our time, the HVAC system is largely hidden from you. Most of it you don't see. Under all these floors, there's a series of radiant tubes that kind of go moving through the floor. They go through and actually either heat or cool the concrete in the floor to some base level, something that's pretty close to what the anticipated load will be, or something to keep the building rooms at a comfortable temperature. So the primary way of heating and cooling this building is through these radiant tubes in the floor, and they can either be heating or cooling. You can actually pump cold water through them too if you want to. Okay, so they have a lot of tubes in here. That concrete, which has a lot of thermal mass, sort of acts as a big battery, either slowly releasing heat in here or slowly kind of cooling things down. Okay. At night, we do a big cool down. We go through and we open the, at the top of the skylights, there's vents that open up and we do something called the big flush, where air, what, the windows on the outside of the building open, the top of the skylights open, and just mostly through just hot air rising, okay, air just gets sucked out of the building and cools everything down. Because what happens overall in the building is, you know, if you think about heating versus cooling, we're all in here, we generate heat, the computers generate heat. For the most part, we generate more heat than is actually leaking out through the walls. So we have a problem of heat building up and we have to get rid of the heat. Okay? Unless you're in a very hot weather climate, it's often that consideration in that people don't cool a space, they almost always heat the space, computers heat a space, so you typically are dealing with excess heat. Okay, so often cooling loads are the ones that sort of dominate. In the middle of a dead cold winter, if you're back in the polar vortex right now, you might be having a heating problem, okay, but it's probably a shorter period of the year that you actually deal with it. So often we're thinking about trying to remove heat. Okay, but in terms of observing what's going on around here, so we have the radiance system in all the rooms, and pay attention as you're walking around the building. All the rooms that are interior spaces or closed spaces that don't have windows, okay, tend to have things like this. They'll have some sort of, this is called a chill beam. There's air coming in. There's also heating or cooling being applied. There's kind of hot or cold water kind of radiating through this. It's like a radiator on the ceiling where air is blowing over the radiator and blowing down into the room here. Yeah?
What kind of sensor is
that? That is actually, is that a camera? I think it's just a camera.
Okay.
It's just a little video camera. So a lot of things are sort of very visible in here. They wanted to kind of keep everything in there. You can sort of see that even in terms of the HVAC system in here, oh, there's the main supply air that's coming through this big kind of rectangular duct. Notice as you kind of even think about the duct, if you follow it around, you can also often figure out really where the air is coming from and where it's going to by following the sizes. Like right now, I can see that it's actually biggest over here. It kind of takes this funny L shape and goes off. Notice as it comes off and different things branch off. There's some circular pipes that branch off it. There's this kind of rectangular pipe that branches off it. Over here, it gets really narrow. And when we go into the other side of this room, chances are it's getting even narrower and narrower still. Because what happens is there's a certain amount of air. It's almost like people moving through the building where we're talking about egress. That is considered to be to feed all these terminals, we add up the total amount of air upstream. So as you go further and further upstream, the ducts tend to get bigger and bigger. Closer to the air handler, more air is pumping through. As we come off and we feed all the individual loads, then it gets less and less, and then it starts getting very small. These little round ducts you can see are actually incredibly pinchy. They come off. They get very small as we actually connect to the chilled beams because they have a very small load to do. The main trunk is supplying a lot. That's actually just supplying one terminus. Although, this is actually a really good example of a good principle about placing ducts too. Notice we have this kind of hardline duct, okay? This is a steel wall hardline duct. It tends to be pretty efficient about moving air. As we got closer and got close to the terminal, notice they actually switched over to, it's this kind of flexi duct, this duct which is kind of, it's almost like a dryer tube. That kind of duct is very good in terms of being able to spatially adjust. It's not the most efficient though. So what we'll do is often at the ends of the runs, we'll do that last few feet with a flexi tube, just so that we then have that little bit of tolerance. Oh, maybe they moved that chill beam over a few inches, or it wasn't quite exactly where it wanted to be. If we had manufactured all that as a lot of hard duct, we'd come on out, and when it didn't fit by just 2 inches, we'd all be upset and have to go back and refabricate. Whereas here, if you allow that last little bit, you're basically putting inefficiency right at the tail end to allow for flexibility. And it's a very common strategy. So that's our supply system. All the air is being supplied. Of course, we have to get rid of that air somehow. So how does it get rid of in this room? Part of it's going to go under the doors, stuff like that. kind of pops out that way typically, but also there are return air ducts, and where the return air is happening is right up in here. You can sort of see at the back of the room, there's a couple of return air grills, and basically we're pulling the air back out that way. There might be some other ones in here, but those are the only ones I can spot. Okay. And somehow if we tally it all up, the total supply and the total return somehow should be in balance. If they weren't, if we were supplying too much, every time you open that door, it would fly open because of the pressure. If it was negative, then every time you tried to open, it would resist you because the negative pressure would be making it hard. Okay, so yeah, in that same principle, I say observe everything around you. Even, let me kind of show you some examples that were kind of hanging around. Let's see if I can find them. Are they in 13? Let me see where I put them. Let me go back to fall. I was going to show you some pictures of some systems that I liked. Oh, there we go. Some nice example photos. I tend to notice things wherever I go. So actually, let me open these another way for you. Find out a little about my life and where I go. That's not such a great picture in terms of the size. Well, maybe it's better to do it the other way. This is Armadillo Willie's, actually the one's located down near where I live in San Jose. If you just start looking around in different spaces and start trying to pay attention to where the HVAC system is, you'll often see things like this. This is kind of a restaurant dining room space. Can you spot the supply air in this space? You should be able to, because it's pretty obvious. They have these big round ducts that are coming through the main restaurant space. You notice on the round ducts, there's these taps on the side. There's grills kind of going out on either side. Very common way of doing it. If you're going to leave ducts exposed, it's often very common to kind of make them round. It looks a little bit better. Doing all these kind of rectangular ducts looks a little bit messy. Often these rectangular ducts are covered over by some sort of ceiling or something. So we have these big round ducts. We have these supply airs kind of coming into the space. You'll see at the end it's just kind of capped off. Can you spot where the return is? Because we always have to sort of supply and return. See anything that looks like a possibility? Let me go ahead and, Britt, where do you see it? Where do you see it? Right there. That is it. So what they're doing here is I can tell somewhere over the kitchen area there's a big air supply handler. It's both pushing air and pulling air back in. We're pushing it into the restaurant, kind of far into the restaurant using these ducts. We're pulling it back just at the end. Same sort of thing is happening here. Notice we're supplying all over the room. We're returning it just on the one spot over there. Okay. In general, you want to make sure that you supply it out to where you need it to be. Return is going to just sort of happen, kind of, it'll always go back there just by having a little bit of negative pressure there. Okay, excellent. Let's look at just a couple others. So, Armadillo Willie's is a great space for any restaurant you go to for checking out things like this. Here's another picture. You can sort of see the supply ducts, the return grills coming on the other side. That's kind of a very common strategy. This is kind of an interesting one. This is kind of something funky going on in the middle of the restaurant. I think there were actually probably two spaces in here. I got a number of things. I have some sort of square duct coming back to the supplies. This looks like it's actually a return, just kind of going straight up. My guess is that there's probably a second air handler. This was probably actually two spaces at one point that had two separate air handlers. One over the kitchen, one over here, and this is kind of a remnant of something that's left there. Okay. Let's go ahead and look here. I like this. This is a restaurant that's up in San Carlos, but I thought it was done pretty elegantly here. Okay. Can you spot the supply duct in this picture? Or the supply return, or the supply grill? Let's try that. It's a little bit dark to see on the picture. If I zoom it in some more, you'll spot it.
Oh, is it on the side?
It's right on the side. It's really, it's an elegant solution. Yeah. points to whoever did this. This is actually really nice. This is right here. Okay. It's all integrated into the ceiling. That's like just a nice kind of common, but it runs the entire length. It doesn't look like it stands out. It's just kind of a very elegant way of doing it. Okay. But let's see if we can kind of come up with a principle here about how this is done. Okay. If you were going to go ahead and kind of describe to me where that is, what is the supply duct closest to? What is the supply grill closest to? You know, versus the inside versus the outside of the building.
Windows.
It's close to the windows. And why would we put a supply close to the windows? Let's think about that.
It's where the most
heat is. Ah, very, very good. If you think about the whole building and how it sort of performs, out near the edges is really where you get the biggest fluctuation, especially near the windows. So during the winter time, that's where it's cold, because you're right by the windows, that's where you want the heat. In the summertime, that's where it's hot, so you want the cool. It makes sense to kind of put it out towards the outside. Then if you're going to put the supply over there, what we tend to do is actually go through and put the return over on the opposite side, because we want all the supply air kind of coming down into the space over here. But what's going to happen is over time, it'll sort of drift over to here. Okay. So what I want to do over on this side is basically return it, bring it back up over on this side. And that's sort of a very common strategy. As you're thinking about laying out ducts or laying out terminals, we'll often go ahead and supply near the biggest variation and then pull back in. So if you think about, it's going to bias towards the people who live in the U.S. that have forced air systems. So actually, let's talk about it for everybody. Britt, you probably had a forced air system. I know you had radiators in the house too, but in the one that had the forced air, how many supply terminals do you think you had in your house? Or what was the rule? Can you sort of describe, like, you know, how are supply terminals like put in there? Is there one in every room? Is there one in the house? How does it sort of work?
I think it's more like one in every room.
That's pretty common. You usually have one supply in every room. In a split system, you tend to have a whole unit in every room so that you can kind of keep every room kind of taken care of individually. How about on the return side? Do you remember where the returns are in your house? Actually, that would be quite uncommon. It could be, but what tends to happen is if we have all the supplies kind of out near the windows, and we'll put one in every bedroom, and maybe there's two in the living room, whatever it is in there, we'll tend to actually go through and have the return. It'll usually be like in my house, there's basically one per floor. And it's actually right in the center of the house. It's kind of over the central hallway. It's usually in some central place. Because again, the idea is I want all this air kind of circulating back towards the return and kind of pulling in. And you might say, well, that sounds kind of strange. Like if there's always air coming into like the bedrooms and the return's out in the hallway, how come you can open the doors? Okay, you should have that negative pressure problem. Okay, but you can even notice it here. If you look over at these doors on the side of the room and you see that little teeny tiny crack at the bottom, which makes it possible to open the door, you know, without sort of scuffing up the materials, that's also letting air go through there. Okay, so what happens is we'll just let air kind of circle under the cycle under the doors and infiltrate out that way. Okay, so you could put grills in there if you need to, but it's often common just to sort of do it that way. Now, in these sorts of systems, as an overall strategy, let's think about it. Forced air systems, what happens? My furnace is actually up in the attic. Do you know where your furnace is? Is it in the basement or is it in the garage? Where's your furnace? Is usually, it's the air handler. It's the part that's a piece of equipment that has a big fan for blowing air in and out and has a heating element or a chilling element. Okay, we call it a furnace, but an air handler is actually a more proper term. Do you remember where it is?
In the basement.
It's in the basement? Okay. Commonly in the basement, mine's in the attic, a lot of them in the garage or in some hallway in the center. But how many do you have?
Just one.
Just one. Most houses have one. Okay, if you have a forced air system, you have one air handler. That air handler is going to blow to the entire house. Okay, and pull it back out. But here's kind of the rub in terms of this sort of system. If that furnace, you're heating up the air or you're chilling the air there, and it's blowing hot or cold air to all the different rooms. Okay, and usually if you sort of blow the air past some heat, it's going to be quite a warm temperature, maybe 90 degrees, maybe 95 degrees, something like that. So you basically have, like 90 degree air coming in over here, and 90 degree air coming in over here, and 90 degree air over there. Pardon me, I can't draw very good with one finger. Okay. The problem is, if the loads in the rooms don't quite balance out, if this is one room and there's a bedroom over here and there's another one over here, if I'm blowing the same air into all the different rooms, and that's either on or off, I have a lot of trouble controlling the temperature in each of the rooms, because if this main room is so cold that I need to keep the hot air on, the bedrooms are probably getting really stuffy. Okay, so that's not a very good system. This is what you'd call it's basically a single zone system. It has one thermostat, it controls the entire house. Okay. It's a cheap way of doing it, but it's not necessarily a good way of doing it because you have that unevenness and you can't really control it. In more modern houses, will be a little bit better, especially two-story houses. Two-story houses tend to have the problem where, since the heat rises, if you blow a lot of hot air in, the second floor gets very hot and the first floor is hard to keep warm because it sort of rises. So you'll sometimes have two zones, upper zone and lower zone, and you can control them independently. And that's quite okay. Because if you don't give me a separate thermostat and I'm stuck in the little room over here and it's hot, the only thing I can do is close the vent and try to keep the heat from getting into the room, which is not so efficient. Now, let's contrast that instead with a more enlightened approach that they might use in other countries. So, my friends with split systems, tell me about that. So I've got some sort of apartment here. Same way. Okay, and you'll typically have some sort of unit. It'll be up on the wall somewhere. Maybe it's over here. Might be over by the windows. So, where does the air blow out?
Outside the wall.
Okay, the chilling happens outside there. How about where does the air come into the room?
It's where in that conditioner is.
Yeah, just kind of blows in. Okay, and where does it go out?
The same place.
Yeah. So, hey, I got a little closed system in here, and that's actually pretty good. Same thing over here. It's going to blow out into here. It's going to come back into there. Ooh, I kind of like this. The advantage of this system is that if I'm running too hot in one room and you're running cold in the other room, I can turn my thermostat one way and just control the flow. You can turn it the other way in the other room. So split systems are actually kind of nice. It's a little more expensive to do that. That's why we typically put one furnace in the garage, because it's kind of a cheap way to do it. Developers would do something like that. But if you really start thinking about these split systems, it's actually kind of nice, because even if I'm not in the room, I'll just leave it off. Whereas in my house, even if I'm not home, the air is probably still blowing and kind of chilling a room that no one's sitting in. Something like that. And that's not very efficient. So split systems are pretty good. Think about this as being, as opposed to that house being one zone or maybe two zones, in this case, every room is its own zone. And how you can spot a zone, I'm gonna use this two different sort of notions. I'm gonna use something called a space, and I'm gonna use something called a zone. And the word space, I mean to refer to a room, some sort of conditioned area, okay? In this case, this might be two spaces. Actually, there's four spaces out there right now. Okay, but depending upon how the thermostat controls things, that'll be a zone. So if, for example, I have one thermostat, which is controlling both of these rooms, okay, that would be a single zone there. But it's probably much more common to zone it like this, so I have two different zones in there. Okay, what's the problem with one zone that has multiple rooms in it? That often leads to a little bit of warfare. It's what's the problem when you have one zone and multiple rooms? Henry, what do you think the problem would be?
Well,
And depending on, I mean, what kind of loads you have in the
Oh, is that? Oh, it's what kind of loads in the room. It's personal preference too. I like warm rooms. If you shared a thermostat with me, you'd be complaining all the time because it'd be so hot. You know, my idea of what's hot and your idea of hot are probably very, very different from each other. That's a problem. Another problem is though, even if you think about this, if the sun is shining over here, and this is the western side of the building, even though I'm kind of drawn backwards from the way I conventionally draw that. The deal is, this room over here has an awful lot of heat coming in through the windows, okay, whereas this room over here on the other side doesn't. Yeah. So if those were both on the same zone, you know, I might just have the cooling coming on the western side of the building, and it's also cooling the northern side of the building. So again, we have people not so happy with each other. So as you zone, you got to think about, oh, how is it used? You know, what time of day is it used? Because if some rooms are 8 to 5 and other rooms are 24/7, you don't necessarily want to have them in the same zone, because then you'd be running it at times it wasn't. Yeah, same thing, orientation, all these things get into zoning. Yes, Henry.
So at a high level, when you're deciding how many zones, how much split things up, how's that fit in with in the context of an owner and MEP designer, who decides?
That's a very good question. Typically what will happen is the MEP designer will make the final recommendation. The owner will sort of set up some requirements and say, you know, that, you know, they want a certain level of performance or a certain level of control that they want to provide as an amenity to the building. So for example, if I went into an office space and I couldn't control the thermostat, okay, that would actually be considered slightly less desirable than one that I can control every room. So as an owner, if I really wanted to offer a real class A plus, very good space, I'd say I want individual control. If you're less concerned about that, you might just say, oh, you know, just zone the whole floor. I just want it cheap. Okay, but typically the MEP designer will take the lead from really what the owner is specifying because there's a cost difference.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a good trade-off in that. No, it's a very tricky one to come up with. Okay. So overall, that's just kind of some random stuff about just thinking about an overall strategy. But before we get into all the specifics, I want you to think about an overall strategy because it really, that'll start to affect a lot of little details. Kind of come up with your overall. So think about, you know, you know, what kind of heating mechanism you might use. Are you going to be using air to heat, or could we use some water to heat? We'll talk about the implications of that, but also be thinking about how the control wants to work and how that would play in your building. So for example, if you have a big public building, maybe it's such a big space, it might be good for every gallery to have its own control, because what I want in the sculpture gallery might be different than the painting gallery versus in the workshop, something like that. Okay, but most of the public spaces might be controlled similarly, although it'd be different on the north and the south sides, things like that. Smaller buildings, it really can be, if you think about the exhibition spaces and the time they want to be heated and cooled versus the offices, okay, they might be on separate zones for that reason. Same thing for the rehabilitation center, you know, the space where, well, a lot of your spaces are open air, which is actually kind of quite okay. Just think about, you know, the difference between when different spaces might be open and really what the temperature differences might want to be relative to that. Even since you have a nice community room people can come in and use, maybe that's on its own zone, so if people are coming in the evening and that has to be heated and you don't want to heat the rest of the space, you know, you can kind of let that happen a little bit separately. So every building has its own sort of funky little strategy, or can have its own strategy. Okay, let's go back over to my little map and just take stock. So the idea is as follows. Observe everything around you and then start thinking about what your performance requirements are. As you're thinking about your requirements, there'll be some things about the whole need to move air. We talked about that a little bit in terms of, oh, there being different ways of approaching that, you know, whether you're going to go ahead and sort of be, well, any of these things could dominate the whole notion of moving air for fresh air, or just the air changing, or heating and cooling. you must provide some things. Okay, other things are sort of more optional. So you can go ahead and think that you must provide a certain amount of fresh air. In terms of how you do it though, even there we have the option of mechanical, natural systems versus hybrid systems. And that's actually a kind of tricky one. We try to use natural cooling and heating as much as possible, but it's hard to count on that. Let's talk about that for just a second, because a lot of us would say, oh, we're going to use natural heating and cooling as much as possible. But let's think about how that's actually going to work. Okay. The idea with natural is, okay, in a lot of buildings where we used to build them and didn't really think about energy so much, we built a big sealed glass box. Okay. And the only thing you could do, you couldn't open the windows, is either air condition it or cool it. Okay? And that would be called a fully conditioned space. Okay. Yeah. Naturally conditioned space would be one where you could say there's no heating or cooling. It's really just pretty much whatever is happening outside. So how are we going to control that? If we're in the space and it's warm outside and we would like it to be warmer, we'd open the windows. If we don't want it to be warm, we close the windows. Same thing with cooling. If it's warm inside and we'd like to cool the space, if it's hot outside, we shouldn't open the windows, but if it's cooler outside, we should take advantage of that. Okay. So strictly, naturally, that's what you're talking about doing with that. At the high level, it's hard to count on that because you're never really quite sure if it's going to be hot or cold outside, whether you can go ahead and use that space or that natural cooling. So we typically end up with a hybrid of those systems, okay, where we'll go ahead and, for example, on a day when we want to cool, we'll have the air conditioning running when it's hot, but as soon as it gets cool enough outside that we don't need to run the air conditioning, we just open the windows instead, we'll turn off the mechanical and let natural happen. And vice versa. In the wintertime around here, this is actually very productive for heating. You know, a lot of times during the day, you don't need to run the heat. You can just sort of count on the sunlight. You can count on just the temperature to be keeping warm enough. Okay, and we'll only kind of kick in a mechanical heating system when the natural system can't keep up with it. Okay, so there's hybrids of those. Okay, let's go ahead and just talk about how we're going to model some of these things. And here's an overall approach to it. At a high level, what we're going to start by doing is just, you know, we're going to compute some requirements. It's always good, before we start throwing a lot of elements in there, to try and figure out, oh, just how many we think we're going to need. I think Henry, you were asking about this last time. How do you know how many terminals you need? You know, because I'm going to start throwing them in there. But it's nice to actually sort of get a little bit of calculation so we have some sense of really how many we need.
That's a question of that.
Yeah.
So regarding that and the image we showed, they have the supply going along the length of the window.
Yeah.
So I've noticed I've sat in a few places where it's right above you, and maybe it may not be cold or somewhere else, but it's like coming straight, like just in your spot, because it's right above you.
That's awful.
You're freezing.
Oh, exactly.
Do you control that by having, is it by controlling the airflow or having?
Well, let's think about it. This is a very good question. Now, you might understand, I am actually very sensitive to this because when I sit under a cold air duct, I feel it very much. You know, I don't have insulation. So I notice this very much. So let's say you need to have 1,000 cubic feet coming into this room. Okay, and I'm gonna do it as one terminal. Okay. And that one terminal happens to be right over Henry here. So think of all 1,000 cubic feet coming down. Now, Britt's going to still get some of it, but it's going to be more dilute. By the time Christine gets it, it's going to be, it's going to be cool enough. She's going to be quite comfortable. But Henry's over here freezing because it's all just on his head. Okay, so that's not good. So if you still have to come up with 1,000, what would be a better way to do that?
Have multiple terminals?
Yeah. So as opposed to 1 at 1,000, maybe 4 at 250 would be better. Or even like in that restaurant where you had that continuous bar, if you think about that whole bar, if it could kind of come in across the entire side of the room, you know, the more area you give it, the lower the velocity, it kind of comes in very gently. Okay, so watch out for that. If you've ever sat, I've done this, you're in restaurants and they put you right under the vent and it's awful. And the way to get around that is to sort of distribute it more evenly. Yeah, good question. Yeah, we can come up with, we'll do a model, I'll show you that. You can model exactly kind of if the air is coming in, especially because that air coming in there, you know, you want the room to be like 72 degrees or whatever you want the room to be. You know, some people want it to be 68. I think that's incredibly cold. But you know, everyone has their own sort of feeling about how cold the room should be. In order to make the room there, the air that's coming out of the terminal isn't 68 degrees or 72 degrees. It's actually like 60 degrees or something like that, because it's going to mix with all the hot air in here and kind of try and keep the temperature down. So the air that comes out of the terminals is either really hot or really cold, okay? Which is why if you have anybody sitting under it, you're in your cloud of 60 degrees, where other people are sitting around at a comfortable 68. So it makes a difference. Now, we used to do this thing, you know, when we were little, on cold winter days, it's a lot of our terminals, the air terminals are on the floor for heating. You'd go on a cold winter day, and you'd take a blanket, and you'd sit right on top of the terminal with your blanket, and it would sort of fill up with hot air, and you'd feel really, really good inside, but no one else would get the hot air. But it's all good. You know, it's like silly things we do. Okay, so we're going to compute some requirements. That's going to be based on sort of the location of the building. It's also going to be based on the thermal properties of the building. So all that thinking about your envelope is going to come in here. So if you go through and you have very efficient walls which block a lot of conduction, a lot of heat transfer, you'll need less heating or cooling. If you sort of have walls that allow more, you'll need more heating and cooling. Okay, we're also going to go do this in terms of the use of the spaces. So this whole notion that a classroom that is full of many people that has computers in it probably has a higher amount of internal load generated, so more heat's being generated here, as opposed to the office across the hallway. Okay, of course, the office across the hallway has windows and we don't, but we need to sort of figure out what the occupancy is and estimate just, you know, when is it going to be used, how much heat's going to be generated, because that's all going to factor into computing what we actually require. After we figure out how much is going to be required, you're going to get some number, and it may be driven by the ventilation, it might be driven by the heating or cooling, but you'll figure out, oh, this room requires 2,500 cubic feet per minute, per hour, yeah. So what we're going to go through and do is figure out how to place that. We could put the 1,2500 right over Henry's head, or we could go through and split it, and maybe we'll have, oh, 8 of them at 300 or something like that. We'll split it around so it distributes it a lot more nicely. But we're going to go through and place some air terminals. We're also going to connect all those air terminals together. That's part of our strategy we're going to do. Then finally, we're going to connect them to some piece of equipment. Okay, and when we're placing the equipment, here's what I want you to think about in terms of this air handler, okay, is that as you place it, notice this, where you place it is sort of related to like how big it needs to be. And let me kind of show you or tell you why, right? It actually affects the ductwork. Let me see if I can come up with a simple example that'll illustrate this. Okay. I'm going to just assume, for example, these are all a series of terminals. And each of these is, let's say, 500 CFM. Okay, so just a bunch of terminals. And I'm going to connect them all with a piece of ductwork. And in terms of my air handler, I decided to put my mechanical room right down over here, so my air handler is over here. So I'm going to go through and create this nice duct connecting all these. So it's going to do this. It's going to come down here, and connect into my air handler. And these are all going to be connected. Okay, so super. Now, each of these are 500. So at the end of the line, it's 500. This is 500. But what happens if you think about the duct is this duct right here is carrying 500. This is carrying 1,000 because it has to be able to supply both those. This duct right here is connecting 1,500. This one is connecting 2,000. And by the time you get back over here, this may be 5,000 or something like that. It's actually quite a lot of air coming through. Now, the impact of that is, if you're trying to push a lot of air through, how big the duct is related to how much air is going through. So, If I need to put 5,000 through versus 500, it might be teeny tiny on the ends, but it might be getting big at the other side. It might be getting to be 36 by 36 or 36 by 48, or it might be getting so large that it's having a hard time fitting into your ceiling. So as a strategy, having a really long run and putting everything at the end of the run isn't necessarily a good strategy. Okay, so let's go ahead and try a different strategy for how we can do this. Like, that's not such a great strategy. Another strategy might be this. What if I put it here in the center? Okay, and then as opposed to having it all connect this way, let's get rid of that over there. Get rid of this guy over here. Now I'm going to go ahead and bring one in over here and one in over here. Okay. By putting it in the center and splitting it, what you've just done is you've actually reduced the load that's coming in from either side to half. So the duct is just going to be smaller. And what's going to happen, they will eventually get to the point where it'll get big, but you can have it happen in a very compact area as opposed to having it string along a long distance. So very often you'll see strategies like this. As opposed to having a huge number of ducts down one branch, kind of breaking it into smaller branches. It'll go through and just kind of minimize it a little bit. Now, this duct over here, even because it's going 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so there's 2,500 across the top and 2,000 across the side over there, even that's getting to be a little bit large. So if I want to make this even sort of more efficient, I could do this. As opposed to bringing it from the end, let's go ahead and bring it from the center. Okay, if I do that, now what's happening? Well, you tell me what's happening. So I got 500 coming each side. I'll just go ahead and fix this on this side. Okay, these shows are 500. Which is the duct that actually has, I'll do this over here. Okay, if it's 500 from each side, coming from the far left, I got 500, I got 1,000. This maybe has, well, this is getting a little big. This is 500, this is 1,000. It's gonna combine together. Altogether, this is 2,500, but it's kind of a shorter distance. More of the duct work is actually staying small. Same thing over here. So you're going to find out the way you lay this out actually makes a big difference. And when you're fighting to get all your ductwork to fit inside the ceiling, that actually sort of adds up. So where you put your mechanical room is kind of important. As we do this, it may be that you're going to decide, looking at your model, to relocate your mechanical room, to kind of think about a more central place to put it. Or you could say, hey, you know, I'm thinking of one mechanical room, but I got these two buildings and they're like 200 feet apart from each other. Maybe I need to have two mechanical rooms. And that's a valid strategy too. You don't necessarily have to run it all back to one space. So, you know, the locations, the spacing, all these things factor into how you decide to lay this out. Okay, enough of all that. That's all your strategy. Let's go back in and let's actually make some of this happen in Revit. So, we're gonna place some terminals, we're gonna connect them together, place some equipment, and bring it all together. So let's go ahead and start with the whole issue of spaces and zones. And to do that, just to give you an illustration, if you could, let's do this. I'm gonna start from scratch here a little bit. Let's go ahead and open up a new mechanical template, and then what we'll do is we'll open, there's an architectural building we'll link in that's in the examples. It's in, I think it's under the session 13 examples, but we'll grab it out there. Let me go ahead and, again, say a new mechanical template. Why do I want the mechanical template? Because it has all sorts of ducts and elbows and bends and things that we're going to need. And if it doesn't have those, you're going to have a hard time routing things. And then what I'm going to do is do a little insert. If you haven't downloaded the session 13 examples, go for in session 13, it's the, It's the first group of examples over there. Let's see if I can find it for you. It's called HVAC system examples 1 through 2, duct placement. And we're going to grab that base architectural model. So what I'm going to do is insert that. I'm going to link in the Revit model. I'm going to do it origin to origin. And I'm going to go over to 13. Get that base architectural model. And you'll see, this is a pretty boring little building. This is like a little four classroom building. But it'll serve our purpose. Go ahead and get an origin to origin. Let it upgrade. We'll take a look. There's my little building. It's kind of hanging around there looking pretty good. But what we're going to do is start thinking about it and thinking about the spaces that are there. So in this building, you're going to rotate it up 3D just so I can sort of see it better. You'll sort of see I can grab things like the roof. And if I grab the roof, let's see what's going on here. It's a wood rafter, insulated. That looks pretty good. All right, it's got an R value of 58. Okay, this looks like it has some pretty reasonable values in this model already. See if I have the walls are. I have to tab a few times to get the wall because it's in a linked model. What is that? It's an R54 wall. That's actually looking pretty good. Okay, so see if you can import that in there. We're going to start by importing, again, we need to get into mechanical template just so we have everything available for us. But we're going to go one step further because what we want to do is for that linked model, we want to say, you know, the walls over in that architectural model, we want to be able to use those walls for the purpose of our analysis. Okay? And how you do that is you choose that linked model. It's kind of in a really weird space, but you choose it and you edit its properties. And you say that you want it to be room bounding, okay? And then it's available to you. What that says is that the lint model's walls can bound the rooms or the spaces in your model. It sounds kind of strange, but if you don't do that, what you have to do is copy the walls. But you don't really want to copy the walls. You just want to sort of allow for them to be here so you can kind of work with them. Okay, super. Now, the difference is, if I go to the floor plan now, pull that out of the way. If I go to my floor plan, if that wasn't set up, let me kind of turn that back off again. And I said I wanted to go through and put a room in here. Sure. Are the rooms? There's nothing to grab onto. There's nothing to grab onto because this is an empty model. There's no walls in there. If you go ahead and turn that back on again, though, you'll see that it can grab on. So I'll go back to that linked model, say, let's go ahead and make it available. And now when I say rooms, I actually have rooms. Okay, now for the rooms and spaces, rooms and spaces are very much similar. You think about spaces are really rooms with a whole lot of analytical properties, okay? For the rooms or the spaces, we always need to go through and adjust the limit offset so it's sure to catch the ceiling or sure to catch the floor above. That's always important. A lot of you hit that already when you're putting in rooms for the daylighting analysis. I'm just gonna make it even taller than I want it to be, because I want to make sure I'm catching it. So I'm going to put some rooms in here. I'll even make a room out of the hallway. Okay, super. This room you see has an area, has a perimeter, has an unbounded height, it has a volume. That sounds pretty good. It even can go ahead, you can put an occupancy in here. There's a lot of information that architecturally we like to think about the room, but it doesn't have much mechanical information yet. So what we're going to do is also create a space in that room. The space starts to have more of what you want in terms of understanding airflow and lighting and reflectance and all that stuff. So spaces live under a slightly different tab. They live under the Analyze tab. And oh, my toolbar is so squished up, it's hard to tell what's going on. It's under the Spaces and Zones area. And right in there you can say Space. I'm tempted to say Place Spaces Automatically. Notice it's picking up the same 12 feet. I probably can do that, or I can place them individually. Let me see. That's a space. I say automatically, let's just try it. Okay. Looks like you did a pretty good job. So you got a bunch of spaces in here. Now these spaces, they're kind of hanging around. You can sort of see, okay, we have some information about lighting. This is interesting. Looks like it's the average estimated lighting level or something like that. I've never noticed that one. Okay. We have some things about the height of the calculation plane. We have some things also about the reflectance of the walls and the floors, which again, sort of affect the lighting. We have some things about the electrical loads. We have some things about the mechanical. Now notice currently the mechanical has a bunch of zeros in there, but we're gonna change that in just a little bit by going through and specifying a little bit about the space. Okay, right now there's not a whole lot of information in there, but when we give it a little information, we'll be able to kind of fill that in. You notice down at the bottom of the spaces, there's this whole notion of, is it occupiable? Okay, that's good in terms of whether we have to count it in a lot of ways. There's the question, is it conditioned? And you'll see there's the notion, is it heated and cooled? Is it cooled only? Is it unconditioned? Is it vented or naturally vented only? Okay, and all those have different sort of implications. Heating, cooled would be both, but a closed system. Unconditioned is, that's the storeroom where you're not even venting it. There's just nothing. It's just kind of completely unconditioned. Or your outdoor spaces are unconditioned, if you have some of those. Vented would be, we're gonna circulate air, but we're not gonna heat or cool the air, okay? Naturally vented is, we're not even gonna push air kind of through the ducts. It's only gonna be naturally vented. Okay, so I'm gonna leave it heated and cooled for now. You have a notion of a space type. By default, the building has a space type. Let's choose that, and then we can adjust individual rooms to have a space type that's a little bit different. So, for example, if this is mostly a classroom building, I can choose that. That'll give us some different sort of assumptions about how much area per person we have to allow, how much heat gain per person, the lighting and power load density. All these sort of different things factor in, even the scheduling. And you can play games with these in terms of really fine-tuning the model to really be very accurate about how the uses are. Let's go ahead and set that as the overall building. Oops, come back over there. Actually, I'll go back to building. I should show you how this actually works together. What's happening is I'm changing it there on an individual basis, but I actually want to sort of change it on the building basis. Maybe I'll do that, and then we'll come back and look at these. There's also the whole notion of the construction type. The construction type is how are the wall surfaces defined? How are the window surfaces defined? What sort of thermal properties? Now, there is this choice called building. Let's talk about that, because we can adjust them individually, or I can set it to building. You might say, well, how do we determine the building space type and construction type? And where you determine that is under the energy settings. So under energy settings, we have the whole notion of the location. We always have to give it a location. We have the building type. So that's going to be this whole thing about, is it a school or a university? What is it? We have the notion of how we really want to go through and analyze it. There's a whole building construction system. For the building system, you'll see by default, everything is overridden. Now what that means is that independent of whatever you put in, it's gonna go through and use these kind of thermal assemblies instead. So what you really wanna do, since you're careful and you model those, is turn these off. And that way it'll use your values instead. So I'm gonna turn all these off, so that it's going to use my individual values. This is useful if you really want to make some quick changes and just sort of say, oh, what if I just changed all the windows to quadruple glazed? It would let you go through and make a change really quickly as opposed to doing it independently. But I'm going to turn them off. Okay. I would like it to use my building elements. It's still not quite there in terms of what I want. There's the building service. That's what kind of heating or cooling system we want to assume is in here. And I'll just leave that as a VAV system. It's a variable air volume system. We're going to push some air through and control the amount of volume going in individual rooms based on how the heating is needed. Okay, That's looking pretty good. Let me go through and change a couple more things that I want to make sure we get. One is, and Henry found this, you do have to make sure export default values is turned on. If you don't, it's not going to go through and grab your thermal properties. So that's actually one that has to be turned on. Although, I'm going to go through and switch over to rooms for a second and turn on one other one, which says include thermal properties. And I'll test this. I think they're both necessary to really get it to do what you want it to do, to really use all your values in analysis. But we play around with this every quarter, and it's always a little bit mucky. My only complaint about this, it's a really good calculator, but the way the interface is laid out, it's a little bit hard to find all the settings that you need to adjust sometimes. Okay, so to be on the safe side, I'm going to say use my thermal properties and turn off the overrides and import the default ones too. So get all those things. Okay, so super. I've got some basic things going on here. That looks good. I can say okay. And now I can go back and sort of adjust my individual rooms. So that's the room. Let me see if I can get the space instead. It's a little bit hard because spaces and rooms are right on top of each other. But you can start to see a little about what's going on here. Actually, let me do this. Since we want these spaces, and spaces are a little bit hard to get by selecting this way, let's make a schedule. And that way we can sort of spot them all pretty quickly. So how about under view? Let us say, let's go through and create some nice schedule. Where'd it go? There's a schedule. Let's see if I can get the spaces. Okay, now in terms of what I want to actually report, let me go ahead and get the space number and the space name. That sounds like a good thing to do. I can say, okay, what else can I get in here? Let me put the area. Maybe I can say the area per person. That'll let me figure out how many people are in there. In fact, I think I can even get a number of people. Okay, that'll tell me a little about that. But I can also get some other things in there. I can sort of say, well, for each of these different spaces, you know, what is its construction type? I can say, what is its conditioning type? So I can really change a lot of these different things in there. Now, something else that is going to be helpful to us in just a few moments, though, is really what I would like to do is go through and put in a couple of different things. I would like to go through and put in the calculated supply airflow. That is how much air, if it calculates, it thinks I need to put in there. And also I'd like to put in there the actual airflow. So then we'll have the two different numbers and be able to kind of balance them. So I'll say calculated supply airflow. I'll say actual supply airflow. And let me see if I can come up with a calculated return airflow. I don't see that. Interesting. I guess it thinks about it more from the supply side. That actually sort of makes sense. Okay, beautiful. Let's go ahead and just pop that up. All these nice spaces. Oh, you know what I forgot? I forgot to put occupancy in there. Yeah, I'll put occupancy in there too. That'll actually help me. Occupancy unit, no, what do they call it? Is it use? Space type is what they call it. I'll move that up. Okay. What this is telling me now is overall it's going to use the same space type as the building. If I know that hallway is a little bit different, I could go through and say the hallway, which looks like it's space 3, is going to be some sort of corridor. Slightly different variation there. Notice that then the area per square foot, area per person is a little bit different. The number of people calculated is a little bit different. We can also go through now, change, the heating and cooling, for example. If in the hallway there, it's not going to be kind of conditioned the same way as everywhere else, I can say really this is going to be naturally ventilated only. I can go and put that in there. Okay, and here's all these calculated things. Notice it isn't computed yet. It also says there's no actual supply or return, but that's okay. We're gonna get to that in just a minute. Okay, but let's pause here for a second. Is that sort of making sense in terms of we have these different spaces? Okay, if that sort of makes sense, then we're ready to go through and do the next thing. First thing is we get spaces, and we're gonna find the uses, and we're gonna do the calculations in a minute to figure out how much heating or cooling is required. Henry.
So we elaborated more on the, so when you click on a space,
yes,
the difference between, like there's actual and then there's specified.
Yes.
Like actual airflow, specified airflow.
Let's talk about that. That's a really interesting distinction.
And maybe.
Okay. So let's think about it. Actual or calculated is when we run the calculations, we run the HVAC calculator, it's going to figure out based on the number of people and the wall constructions and the weather profile outside and whether you said to heat or cool it, all those different things, it's going to figure out how much hot or cold needs to come in. So it's going to give me a certain amount of CFM that it thinks is going to be required to supply that. That's calculated. Okay. Specified is, you can say, independent of what was calculated in the requirement, this is how much you want to use. That could be a little higher, it could be a little lower, depending upon, you know, how willing you are to tolerate kind of slightly less than desirable conditions or how much you want to overcompensate. So if it calculates 1,875, you could say that your specified is 2,000, or you could say that your specified is 1,500. Yeah, depending on how you want to go on that.
And do you know, like, when you run the energy analysis,
yes,
GBS, does it use this actual or specified?
I would guess at that point it would actually use the calculated.
Oh, the calculated.
Yeah, I think it's just going to use the calculated. I think that even though you go through and you put all your ducts in and you do all that stuff, that doesn't actually reflect itself back in the GBS. At least that's my understanding. If it did, I'd be surprised. I'd be pleasantly surprised if it did. I don't think it does.
Okay, and this includes the outside air temperature and the sun, or is it just,
yes,
the occupancy of the space?
No, it includes the outside temperature through the location. Because you put location in, it has a weather profile. So it's quite, you know, hey, this thing's actually doing a lot of work for you in terms of what's going on. It'll go through and calculate the loads. Now, we came up with almost everything. There's one more thing that we have to do to kind of make it really get ready for the calculation, and that is, we haven't yet told anything about the zoning. So, in terms of, are they all in one zone? And if they are, what's the heating and cooling set points? There's all these different things, okay? So, we still need to set that, but ultimately, after we calculate, it'll fill in all those values, and then after we fill in those values, yeah, then we can sort of choose which is the one that we want to let dominate. Okay, the actual is actually going to be based on what you really put into the model. So if you put in 5 at 500, it'll come up and say 2,500. Okay, so let's go off and do some zoning. And how you do that is, zones actually sort of exist, right next to the spaces. They're kind of also in the same zone. There it is. By default, everything is in something called the default zone. There's one zone that's considered to be for the whole building. If you say zones, you get some funny tool right now. Modify HVAC zones. Hang on, I gotta think about this. That's for editing the zone. Everything's just in default right now. That's adding a space to the zone. I want to actually create a new zone. Let's see if I can figure this out. Define zones. Oh, looks like I just created a new one right there. Oh, interesting. The first one created the default. Interesting, you probably put them all in there. In terms of this one, let me see if this will actually work. If I say add a space, what I want to try and do is add the two spaces down there. I'm going to call those my south side rooms. Let me go ahead and create another zone. I'm going to add a space here and add a space there. Those are going to be my north side rooms. So I think I actually have three zones now. I have the default, which is the leftover, and then I have the north and the south side. But to verify this, what we can do is actually we create a zone schedule too, if you want to. If you come over and say schedules, actually, zones don't come in there, do they? The MEP zones? HVAC zones. There they are. Okay, and what I'll do here is I'll have a zone name. I could have the area of the zone. It's a gross area. Notice some other cool things that are sort of interesting here. There's the heat set point and the cooling set point. If you've ever fought with someone over a thermostat, this is where it makes the difference. You can go through and set it there. I can say there's the gross area, maybe the occupied area too. That'll just be the difference of anything that's not occupiable. Okay. Let's go for that. So here's my zone schedule. Looks like my zone 2 is empty right now. So even here, I can say that, what is this? Really, I know this is my hallway. Can I edit it there? Doesn't look like I can. That zone 2 I might just want to get rid of because it's not really doing anything for me. Okay, so I got a couple different zones there. Oh, even in here, you can go through and say whether it's the condition type, blah, 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 or the system type, service type. So it can be the building service, or if we want to change so that it's hot air in some areas, but it's radiant in some areas, we can do that. Okay, so we have all these things. We are pretty close to being able to go through and do our analysis. Now, as you want to go through and do the calculations, that all exists under the Analyze tab. It all hangs around under, I have to go to the floor plan. What's it doing? I'm in the middle of something. Space tag, space separator. Check the systems, energy analysis, reports and schedules, heating and cooling loads, there we go. Panel schedules, schedule quantities. Okay, let's take a list. Under heating and cooling loads, what it'll show you is that's actually the energy model that it's going to use. You can sort of see it's a school using the same energy information. It's in Boston, that's where I left it there. The ground plane is at 1. If you have an underground building, you can set it up to be level 2 or level 3. Okay, the phase we want to use, overall it's going to be a VAV system. The building construction, again, we looked at this, I'm just going to use the actual thermal properties. Infiltration class, this is the whole notion. Are you a tight building, are you a loose building? Generally, newer buildings are pretty tight in terms of how much the infiltration is. Older buildings tend to be fairly loose, or just nothing. We have this notion of load credits. Load credits I was looking up to. I was trying to figure out what that was doing before we came into class. Load credits is if, for example, we want to say that, what? If there's sort of residual that will help out, we should take that into effect that it'll use us. And what that means is, like, for example, generally, in terms of the HVAC calculations, it won't go through and include in the heating effect of the computers or you. It'll just sort of do it in terms of what's happening, you know, in the outer envelope and the weather and stuff like that. I would turn that on, because what that is going to do, that'll do a better job of accounting for these internal loads. Okay. It also does a better job of, it's kind of an interesting thing, if, for example, this room was really, really cold and that room needed to be cooled, okay, it'll let the cool from this room sort of go through the wall to go through and cool that room too. So in general, load credits is actually a pretty good thing. It tends to make, I think, a more accurate model. It makes the model a little less conservative because you're taking advantage of an effect that generally is going to have a positive effect to you. You can either just save these settings if you want. Let me go back and do that again. Or I can look at the details. The details is really just showing you here are the zones. It's just the information presented in a different way. So this is very much like looking at it in the schedule, just in a graphical view. You can sort of see what the rooms are under each of those. And for each of these, you have a little bit about the lighting, the people, the power, all these things. They're all kind of hanging around in here. Now, as you're looking at this, if you happen to on your building come in here and you see a lot of those little yellow yield signs with the exclamation point, that means there's something about the space that isn't well defined. Most typically, it's just that the height of your space isn't hitting the floor above or isn't hitting a ceiling. So it's just undefined. That just means go back and go to the space and change it so that it does hit it. That's the most common problem people have with this. Okay. But if you run this and say, let's go through and do some calculations, it'll go through and calculate. And it does kind of a pretty quick job of it. Sort of a quicker set of calculations than the GBS calculations. But here's what it's telling us. Overall for the building, based upon what we've told it so far, okay, at this latitude and longitude, with this summer dry bulb temperature and winter dry bulb and mean daily range, for a school or university with this area and this volume, it gives us overall a number for the peak heating load and the peak cooling load. Okay, that means when, if we have a single air handler, all the system, or even multiple, all the systems have to add up to provide that. We have to be able to go through and provide so many BTUs per hour, okay, in terms of heating and cooling. You'll see there's also a peak cooling airflow and a peak heating airflow. And that's how much air it would take to move that much heat or cool through the spaces and have the effect we want it to have. So at a high level, that's what's going on with the building. But if we go zipping on down, it also breaks itself into zones. Zones sort of will tell you that's the default zone. That's the hallway, kind of what's required there. Zone summary 3, I think that's, I forget if it's the north or the south side rooms, but it'll tell you what's going on there. On one side, we have a cooling load of 149. Let me come over and look at the other side. There's the individual spaces in the zone. There's 3, let me go to 4. There it's 142, so it's 149 versus 142. That tells me a little bit in terms of the cooling load. I can tell which side's the south side. I should have done a better job of actually giving them a name. But it's going through and basically for each of the zones telling us, it's actually even going through and it'll tell you for the individual rooms. So for space 3 right now, which has an area of 694, you can sort of see that it has a heating load airflow of 1,010, a cooling of 1,296. So that information is telling us that independent of the air changes per hour, okay, just for a heating or cooling standpoint, we're gonna need to, if I want to meet both those, come up with 1,296. So again, that could be 4 at 300, it could be 4 at 400, or 4 at 350. It could be 6 at 250. You can decide how you want to split that up. Okay, super. Another thing that's sort of telling you it's kind of interesting in here is you can also sort of see the whole notion of really where is the load coming from. In this case, you can see that in terms of the cooling load, interesting, 87% of it's coming through the roof. So I'm going to look at those roof properties. Those roof properties are a little strange because I thought the roof actually had pretty good thermal properties. But that looks very high to me in terms of the percentage that's coming that way. If you look at, in terms of from its calculations, how much is going through the windows, it's not getting anything to the window there. The wall's getting 36, so I'm a little kind of perplexed, but we'll go back and sort of figure out where the specific difference is. Again. Okay. But at a high level, this will give us some information. And what we're gonna do over the next couple sessions is keep on tweaking this report and getting finer and finer to get better and better results. Okay, what should happen is as we change the thermal properties, okay, or as we go through and change the occupancies, any of those things, these numbers just keep on adjusting to sort of indicate a different heating and cooling load. Okay, so the high level, get your spaces, get your zones, and you're in pretty good shape there. And figure out your loads. Okay, if you've done that, let's go back over to your floor plan. And you come back and choose the space now. Notice now there's a supply airflow, okay, of 3,000 over here. Okay, There's a supply airflow over here of 3,200, or the calculated, okay? So basically, as we're going through and trying to meet this, I know that in order to meet the needs, I'm gonna have to go through and provide that 3,279, okay, in that specific space. So there's a long-winded way of saying you use this thing as a calculator to help you figure out how many terminals you have to put in there. Okay, so far so good? Okay, if you've gone through and computed all these values and now you know how much needs to go through and be there as the calculated supply airflow and the calculated, well, the returns are just going to match it. Okay. We're going to need 3279. We're going to come up with our strategy for how to do that. So what do you think? For 3279, what kind of terminals would you like to put in there? If I put in 500, that'd be like around 3,000. If I put in there, if I put it in 8 terminals, that'd be around 400 apiece, something like that. You know, we also got to decide how many terminals you want to put in there. As a general starting point, around 500 is a pretty good starting point just to sort of think. So if I said 500 of them in there, all right, each of them was 500, and I wanted to go through and kind of match that, here's what I would do. Okay. You're going to go through, and when you're placing these, it often makes sense to put them on a ceiling plan, because if you, again, we can talk about terminals, whether they're going to go on the ceiling or the floor or the walls. They're all sort of perfectly valid strategies. They have slightly different implications about how the air mixes in the room, but that's okay. But let's go ahead and put a few terminals in here. I will say, on the ceiling plan of level 1, now that is not good. What's not a properly enclosed region? Did I move the space? Let me back up. I think I must have pushed it out of the way somehow. Okay, looking at the ceiling plan. So I got a nice little ceiling kind of hanging around in there. What I can do is now start putting some terminals on there. Put an air terminal on here. Let me go ahead and put some supply diffusers. That sounds pretty good. Okay, and let me see if I can find even, someone else found one that was even better. It was like face mounted. This one's just kind of hanging around in there. Oh, come on you. It's just out on the floor now. I'm just gonna put it up at 9 feet for now. I think there's other types that are mounted that'll mount to the face of the ceiling. So I'm going to go through and put in here. Notice the flow is by default 500. So I'm just going to go through and put in some of these. Okay, got 4 of them in there right now. If you want to check on how you're doing, go back over to your floor plan, and you can kind of choose the space over there. See what's going on here. No, I have to do the recalc. Let me see if I have to do the recalc. Analyze. Let me do my load calcs. What is going on? It should be in there. I'm going to think about why it doesn't look like it's appearing in the room in just a second. Because it should be. It's in the space. Let me think about this. It should be there. I want to go in there. In my other example, it is doing it there. What am I doing? Let me just see if I'm doing something funky here. Looks like they're right. Oh, let me just check the whole issue of the ceiling. Maybe it's not in the space. Aha! There's always something. See, my ceiling's down a little bit lower and these are outside the space. Let's try that again. like the ceiling's at 8 feet. So I'm gonna choose these and put them down at 8 feet. Okay, and now let's check it out. Still not. I'm gonna try doing the calculate. I know we're gonna beat this eventually because they're gonna show up in there. Still not showing it. So I'm gonna think about why that is in just a second. Although it's got those, I might still have to kind of link them back into a system in order to make this work. No worries, hold that thought for now. We're gonna get into gonna connect in there eventually. I'm gonna think in just a minute about whether, since they're not in a system yet, it's gonna consider them or not. How about this? Let's go over to, if you can, over to another model where this has already sort of been put together. Go to session 13, go to the one that says HVAC examples 3. And go through and grab, for example, 3F, 3B. Let's grab that one. That's just something a little bit further down. I don't want to sort of get you confused about the whole notion about why those aren't showing up yet, just because of some little modeling error I made. Okay, doing a little processing, coming on in there. Okay, it's a little bit further in the scheme. This is basically the same building, just with a little more information kind of put in there. What I can do now is, again, you sort of see I have some air terminals. I've already routed them to some ducts over there. We'll do that in just a second. Let me just kind of check on this issue of the spaces and whether they're reporting it right. It's getting the return airflow. It's not getting the exhaust. And actually, it is getting it. Okay. So what's supposed to be happening is as the stuff is put together, it's put together in a system, notice what happens is for the space, it actually shows the actual supply airflow in the actual return airflow. Let me try that. You know that right now, at least the way this one was defined, blah, 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 the specified, the calculated supply airflow was going to be 1,600. The actual is 1,000. For this one, it looks like I'm a little bit less than I want to be. So if I wanted to, I could go through and try changing the terminal. The supply is over here. If I made that instead a 750 or an 800, what should happen is in the space, it's up to 1800 there now, super. If I come back over here, again, change that one to 800. You'll see that if I come back to the space, now we're up to 1600. Okay, so there is this interconnection between the loads and what you actually put in there, although I'll figure out in just a second what's going on in terms of why I'm not actually sort of getting the properties that I want in terms of being considered to be in that space. And we'll get that figured out. It's going to have something to do with where the models are linked. I know it's going to be something like that, but I'll get that figured out. But at a high level, think of this as a calculator. It's really just you have spaces, you have uses, you have occupancies, blah, blah, blah. You put it all together, it calculates loads. You model things, you put it all in there, and it ultimately comes together. So it starts with that. Now, as you go, it starts with spaces and zones. Okay, there is an issue about air handlers and then air terminals and ducts and how you tie it all together. Air handlers are their own separate topic, and we'll talk about them a lot more next time in terms of all the different places you could put an air handler. Because if you think about an air handler, very often we put them on top of the roof because there's a lot of space up there, and it's often in the center of the building. But if we want to, we could put them outside the building. We could put them underground in a vault. We could put them in the basement and have vents coming to the side. We could put them on the first floor and have vents. There's like all these different places. An air handler is just really a big piece of equipment with a fan, and it pulls on in. In your split system world, it's kind of interesting. You have a lot of the units sort of inside the room up in that little kind of thing at the top. But the part that I would typically think of as being like the air handler, the air handling is handling locally, but the chiller is located, where in like your building is the chiller actually located? Because usually for that split system, there's part that's inside, the air handling is handling locally, but there is some sort of a pump, like a heat pump somewhere, or there's a chiller or a condenser.
The chiller, the condenser is outside the window.
Okay, just outside the window? Very good. Very common, it'll just be outside the window. For many apartments, it'll be on a little ledge that's over near the kitchen or something like that. In a very expensive building, sometimes they'll put it in a special place. They have all those floors with the gardens that are halfway up the building. They'll put them in there, something like that. But you always need some place where the chillers are too. Okay, that has to be outside the space. Okay, but we'll go through and kind of talk about that. But let's just look to finish up today at this sort of funny little model and think about some of the things going on, independent of the loads calculating, that I gotta factor in here. Okay, so zoom on in here if you can, or zoom on out. And let's just take a look at this overall system. So this is a system, and this system is not very well designed. I'll be the first to say that in terms of like how it would be laid out to be efficient. Because what's happening here is, in my system, well, it's kind of halfway reasonably designed. I have some big old air handler up on the roof, in this case. Notice that the air handler basically has kind of a duct coming down that goes to the supply. It has a duct that's coming up on the other side, which is returning the air. So it's going up through the roof and doing that. But if you look at the overall layout, you'll see that there's a large central sort of supply. It tees here and goes off and feeds four on one side and four on another side. Okay, it sort of feeds on the other side. Okay, and that's kind of okay. We could go ahead and try and reorient this a little bit differently so that right now, because we have four chaining together and then eight coming together when it finally comes to the tee, the ducts are starting to get a little bit big over here because there's basically, it's picking up 500, 1,000, 1,500, or now since we changed it, it's now 800, 1,600, it's picking up a little bit more. So I could think about redesigning this a little bit. I might try to go through and redesign this so that basically I came through the middle on both sides, and that way each individual side would only have 1,000 or have 1,500 or something like that. But again, there's lots of things we can sort of do there. But let's just talk about the effect of these ducts on the size of them. So ducting, if we're gonna start putting ducts down, are actually pretty straightforward. Here's what you do with ducts in terms of, I'll just do this outside the building so it'll sort of make or be easy to see, but you can imagine it being inside the building too. If I'm gonna go through and put some terminals down there, so again, I'm gonna say, let's go through and analyze, on systems. I'm going to put in some air terminals. Hi, gang. Are you coming in for a class?
No.
Are you working on like an assignment?
Yeah.
Okay, no worries. Hang tight. We'll be done in about 10 minutes. Okay, sounds good. Okay, so I'll put these at 8 feet up again. Let's go ahead and I'll just put some more returns out here. When it comes time to route them together, here are some of the things you have to start thinking about. So I have some terminals, you can imagine those being in rooms. If I'm gonna go through and put a duct in, I'll choose a duct. When I choose a duct, there's a couple of things I need to consider. It's the question of, do I want it to be a square duct or a round duct? Okay, and then how do I want the join conditions to happen? So let's talk about that. Because joins either work as elbows. Elbows are very, very efficient because you don't have a sharp corner, the air flows around really nicely, but they also take a lot of room to put an elbow in there. Something like a tap is less efficient, okay, but it actually could fit in a lot less space. So you'll see this existing system has a bunch of elbows. Let's just try that first, a rectangular duct with elbows. Let me say mitered elbows and T's. What'll happen is, as I go through and put in a duct, and I'll just choose a size, oh, let me just guess that it's gonna be 12 by 12 first. I know it's not gonna be, but that's a good starting point. I get to say really what height it should be. In this case, I'm going to put it, I'm going to put it relative to reference level 1 and put it at like 10 feet above the floor. So I'm going to run a nice duct, just kind of running right down here. Now, as I round the corner, since it has a mitered elbow or a T, notice that it actually created a very skinny little connection there. Notice on the other hand, if I go through and change that to a radius elbow or a T, do the same basic thing, you'll take a radius in there. So why do I tell you that? It's just as you're going through and working, if you have trouble squeezing things in, and the most common thing is just it'll fight you and tell you, I can't make a piece of ductwork that has that radius and that has that kind of dimension to it. Okay, yeah. If you don't have room for it, consider going to a less efficient connection that just fits into more space. Because you spend a lot of time just fighting with that. Okay, so we're going to run some ductwork. The nice thing about the ductwork tool is it's actually very versatile. If you go ahead and kind of keep on going, it'll keep on making lots of nice little connections. That part's good. If you T, it'll put all the connections in there. It actually does a pretty fantastic job in terms of what you want. It's very smart about what it does. Again, always within little caveats of it has to have parts that it knows how to make that connection. If it ever gives you a can't find an auto route solution, that just means either your geometry or the parts that are available aren't allowing it to connect. There's nothing wrong with what you're doing. Okay, so we put in some ducts. Often what we'll do is we'll come on in and we'll get close, but we won't actually connect. Let me tell you why that is. If you actually connect all the way through, and you're a really good aim, you might actually be able to get it all the way in there, okay? Although it's a different system, that's okay, I'll let that be. And what it'll do is actually put it in there. Okay, and it did not such a bad job. There's always the possibility that the space won't allow for that radius. Notice it requires a radius in there if I do it as a hard duct. So the other way to do it is to go through and get close and make the last few feet with a flexi-duct, okay, kind of like what we did here. And that'll typically buy you a world of tolerance in terms of if that's up just a little bit too high or off by a little or something like that. The nice thing is, though, if you do go through and move things, watch this, it's kind of cool. Once you get it hooked up, if you move it sideways, the duct moves with it. It's actually pretty smart about what it's doing. In fact, that's probably where the problem comes. Sometimes it's trying to be too smart. And then it's fighting you because what you think is sensible should work, but it's not quite there. But as you go through and get started, just start by going ahead and figuring out where the terminals should be and thinking about your overall strategy for linking them together. Okay, and then we can go through and analyze the system. We'll talk more about how to build a system next time. But what I want to show you as a final thing today is this notion of sizing the ducts. That's where this all sort of finally comes together. I take the ducts. You'll see I have a bunch of ducts which are part of a blue system, and I have a bunch of ducts which are part of a pink system. What I have to do is, if I'm going to size some things, I don't want any open ducts. So what I actually have is on the end of this duct, I have a little thing called a cap right there. It just really caps it off. In fact, if you want to see caps, these are actually capped by having a duct or a grill on them. We should find some that just have little caps on the end. It's just really something just to kind of, seal it off, because you don't want air blowing out the sides. Okay. Once you do that and you have it capped off, what you can do is as follows. Let me take all these and, I'm gonna break it right here, just so that I can have it being a little bit different. I'm going to say, as you might have done when you first got started, that all these ducts are, some smaller size. Hang on. I got too much going on here. That one. You might have guessed these are going to be 12 by 12, which is often a pretty good guess. Looks like there's something over there that's a little bit big too. What's going to happen at some point, you're going to figure out that you need to go through and size these things and be a little more careful about the sizes based on the real airflow. So let me show you how that works. I'm going to try and I'll get rid of some of these just because those will be a little bit cleaner. I'm just going to rejoin these. There's some connections in there that were already sized. So if I try to resize it, it might fight with me a little bit. So what I'm going to do is actually just pretend that I hadn't done that already and reconnect all these. And I'll bring these back in. Okay, so my duct system is back in place here, although it's a little undersized right now, I am imagining. What is the size that's required? It's based on just the amount of air flowing through. So if we have more air flowing through, typically it has to be bigger. If it's less air flowing through, it can be smaller. There we go. So how do you size it? What you can do is actually do this. Let me zoom on in a little bit. If you choose the whole system, okay, you can say, let us go ahead and take a look at the duct system. We can break it up and divide it if we want to. In this case, what I'm going to do is do something called some duct sizing. Duct sizing does this. If I choose the duct system, you can sort of specify a criteria that you want to sort of meet, whether you want to sort of control the velocity within the ducts or whether you want to control the friction loss within the ducts. It's a lot of good material in some of the other classes that really talk about all the different ways you might want to go through and consider this. But I'll just kind of use velocity as the criteria right now to kind of make sure that it never has any bigger than 1,000 FPM going through. So what's going to happen if you can sort of picture those 3,000 cubic feet moving through a 12 by 12 space, the duct's going to have to get bigger in order to achieve that for the cubic feet per minute. So let's go ahead and do this. We can say that we want to restrict the height or not. If you restrict the height, it needs to be bigger. It may stay 16, but get fatter and fatter. If you don't, it'll probably be squarish. But the idea is you really want to make sure that it sizes, but not so tall that it conflicts with your structure or other parts of your building. So if you say okay to that, it'll go through and do some calculations. And you'll see what it did is as follows. Give me a little warning. The warning was related to this. This end piece over here doesn't have anything flowing through it. There's just a little cap on the end. So it didn't really know how to size that. There was zero flow. So I can make that smaller if I want. But if you come through and now choose this, you'll see that that is now an 11 by 11. This one over here is getting to be a 15 by 16. This one over here is getting to be 18 or 19 by 16. This one over here is also 24 by 16. So what's happening, it's getting bigger and bigger as you go back through. And that's really the essence of the challenge in all this is really, as you string them all together, it's how far can you go and how much air can you pick up till those ducts get to be so incredibly large that you just don't have any place to put them anymore. So that's another thing that factors into how you decide where to kind of scatter your air handlers. Because if having one air handler and trying to bring your entire building back to that means that you have just too much going on, then you know it may be much more productive to split it into several different air handlers. Like Gustavo, I think for you on your building, there's probably one or two air handlers in the main building, and I could even think of that whole attic space. Yeah, it's really having its own air handler because it's kind of a different sort of needs. Yeah, Rip, for you, I can think of definitely the two buildings having different air handlers. Okay, maybe even the third one for the little office wing between them or something like that. Okay, so let us adjourn there for today. The important things to think about as you kind of head into the weekend are, Get your structure sort of like feeling good, so that feels nice. If you have questions about what to analyze or want some guidance, come see us. In terms of HVAC, just be thinking ahead to this whole issue of, okay, you know, where are my air handlers going to be? Where are these? If I'm pushing air around, I need to push some air. I at least need to ventilate space. If I'm not heating and cooling through the air, I'm doing it radiantly, then I can have smaller ducts because it's only ventilation air. It's not heating and cooling air. Okay? But think about where the ducts might run and where these air handlers might be, you know, relative to this whole notion of, oh, how many you want to control, how many zones. Just be doing some strategy thinking about this. And then we'll take a look at that and we can start sort of building it all together. Next time we'll kind of show you, there's a lot of examples out there, we'll show you different variations of air handlers and terminal locations, whether you want them in the ceiling, whether you want them in the floor, whether you want them in the walls, where you want the air handler on the roof or outside or in the basement. I got little Revit models that show all those different things. Cool, and we'll figure out how to model all those different cases. Okay, let us adjourn.